would like to thank the organizer for the invitation. And then today we will talk about, well, I will explain how adopting a Bayesian view on the stochastic Lucerne bandit problem allows to derive efficient index policies. And more specifically, I will come up with some actual optimal policies. So first, let me introduce the classical stochastic Lucerne bandit model. So it will be much easier than the previous talk by Richard, which was handling the combinatorial setting. Each, we are going to draw only one arm at a time. So a bandit problem is simply a collection of probability distribution. And an agent interacts with this probability distribution by choosing at time t and arm at to draw. And then you observe a reward that is drawn according to the associative distribution. And it interacts with the bandit using a sequential strategy, sometimes called bandit algorithm, meaning that the arm chosen at time t plus 1 can only depend on the past chosen action, a1 up to at, and the past observed reward, x1 up to xt. And the goal, as in Richard's setting, is to minimize regret, which means the difference between the expectation of the maximal reward obtained by drawing always the best arm that, of course, we don't know, minus what we get with our actual strategy. So a classic example, the motivating example for considering bandit models, is that of clinical trial, in which the different arms model the response of a medical treatment across patients. And so these are modeled naturally by Bernoulli random variable, giving 1 if the patient is ill and 0 otherwise, with a no probability of success. So minimizing regret in this setup amounts to maximizing the number of patients that have been healed during the study, which is a natural goal. So this is a particular example of a parametric bandit model because each of these arms is as a distribution parameterized here by a single parameter, the mean. And this example belongs to a larger class of parametric bandit models that we are going to study today, which are the exponential family bandit model. So in these models, the arms all belong to what is called a one-parameter, then a one-dimensional exponential family, so a set of probability distribution parameterized by a natural parameter theta, whose density has the following form. And what is cool about exponential family is that actually there is a one-to-one mapping between this natural parameter theta and the mean of the distribution. And in bandit model, our parameter of interest are the means of the distribution, so therefore we are going to denote by nu sub mu the unique distribution in the exponential family that has mean mu. And we will also define an important quantity to measure the complexity of the problem. So d of mu mu prime will be the cubic Likert divergence between the distribution of mean mu and the distribution of mean mu prime. So here is an example of the function d in the example of Bernoulli bandit model, but the exponential family also encompasses Poisson reward, exponential rewards, Gaussian rewards, so several other interesting parametric models. So now, like in every statistical model that is parametric, we can choose to adopt two different approaches, the frequentist or the Bayesian approach. So we consider mu of mu, so a set of probability distribution in an exponential family, so this is our exponential bandit model. And in the frequentist view, we view the means, mu1 up to muk, as unknown parameter. And then the sequence of reward drawn from each arm is IID, distributing according to a mu of muk. And the regress that I already introduced is then a frequentist quantity, so it depends on the unknown parameter of the arm. Whereas in the Bayesian view, the mu1 up to muk are no random variables that are drawn from some prior distribution that we denote by pi a, and then it is only conditionally to the parameter mu that the sequence of reward are IID. But we could take the same measure of performance, but average under these different probabilistic models, which leads to the definition of Bayesian regret that we call bias risk in the rest of this talk, which so includes an additional average over the prior distribution. So now we need algorithm to minimize either the regret or the bias risk, and today we're going to look at the particular class of index policy. So an index policy simply computes one index per arm, so here IAT only depends on the rewards observed so far from arm A, and then one simply has to look at the highest index and place the corresponding arm. So this kind of policy has been popularized by the UCB type of policy by Howell et al., for example, and this can be qualified as frequentist because the index are based on the confidence interval on the unknown parameter of the mean. But it is interesting to know that actually the very first index policy was proposed by Gittins in 1979 in a Bayesian setup, and therefore the index is based on the most natural Bayesian tools, which is the current posterior distribution over the parameter of the mean. So we will denote by pi at the distribution of mu a given the observation we have so far from arm a. And so I'm going to present a few index policy inspired by the Bayesian view on the multi-harmonic problem, but that will be proved to be efficient, if not optimal, with respect to the frequentist measure of performance, that is the regret previously introduced. So before presenting this Bayesian index policy, I will remind you of the notion of optimality that we consider, as well as the frequentist state-of-the-art algorithm that you heard a little bit about this morning. So our notion of optimality comes from the important Lyon-Robbins lower bound on the regret. So first, the regret can be rephrased as a function of the number of draws of an arm up to the current time. So NIT is the number of draws of arm A up to time T. And so the regret we write this way. So in order to have small regret, we have to draw not too many times the arms for which this suboptimality gap is non-zero. And the Lyon-Robbins lower bounds tells you that any good bandit algorithm has to draw the suboptimal arms in a logarithmic fashion, and it is more precise than that. It tells that the expected number of draws of arm A up to time t is asymptotically lower bounded by log t divided by this quantity, so d mu a mu star. We have our d function here, so this is the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the distribution of mean mu a and the distribution of mean mu star. And so this lower bound leads to our notion of asymptotic optimality being an algorithm for which this lower bound is actually is matched. Okay, so first, it is possible to build asymptotically optimal algorithm using the popular optimistic principle leading to this UCB types of algorithm in which the index are going to be some upper confidence on the mean. And actually, to have an asymptotically optimal, one has to be very careful on the way we build the confidence interval. So Richard already talked about this. So this is the KL-UCB algorithm, in which the index is constructed using the Chernoff concentration inequality. So it does not have a closed form, but it is based on the function d itself, and to compute it, you just look at the function d of the empirical mean x, the function of x, and you threshold this function at the level approximately log t divided by the number of times the arm has been drawn so far. And so it has been proved that the KL-UCB algorithm is asymptotically optimal. So here we are, we have an index policy that is asymptotically optimal. So why bother continuing? Because actually Lyon-Robbins lower bound is an asymptotic result, so it can be that some other index policy would have more efficient practical performance than the index to compute the KLUCB index, you have to solve some optimization problems. So we can expect to have indexes that are more easy to compute and also more easy to generalize to more complex bounding models. So the first Bayesian solution I will propose is actually inspired by the Bayesian optimal solution itself. So what is that? So if we want to minimize bias risk in place of frequentist regret, we have to find a strategy that maximizes the expected sum of rewards if the expectation is also taken under the prior distribution. And this problem actually has a closed form solution, so we don't need to define a notion of asymptotic optimality in this case, because you can see the problem this way. So you have your current posterior distribution over the arms, then each time you draw an arm, you observe the rewards, and your posterior gets updated. So it's exactly like a state evolving in some Markov decision process. And so the theory of MDP tells you that indeed there exists an optimal policy and that it is solution of some dynamic programming equation. So just to give you a more precise idea of the MDP, so imagine the simple Bernoulli case, in which so each arm is a Bernoulli distribution. You assume a Gaussian, a uniform prior over the mean, and then there is a closed form for the posterior distribution, which is a beta distribution whose first parameter is the number of one observed so far, and the second parameter is the number of zero observed so far. So in that case, the bounded K would be summarized by a matrix for which each row gives you the current number of zeros and ones observed from this. And in that case, for example, if you draw arm 2 and you observe a reward 1, you are going to update this matrix this way. So the problem is that even in the Bernoulli case, the state space is huge, so all these possible matrices, and so actually solving the dynamic programming equation is not possible. But Gittins, in 1979, came up with a really interesting dimension reduction argument, but in a slightly different setting. He was interested in solving the discounted multi-arm bandit, that is, in place of maximizing the sum up to some finite horizon T of the reward, he wanted to maximize the sum up to an infinite horizon of the discounted reward, where alpha is some parameter between 0 and 1. And in that case, he proved that this complicated strategy solution of dynamic programming equation reduces to an index policy. And the Gittins index depends on the current posterior over the arm and on the discount parameter alpha. So in our setting of interest, so the undiscounted MAB, it is also possible to define the Gittins indices that will be a function of the current posterior distribution and of the remaining time to play in place of the discount parameter. So just for the sake of completeness, I will try to explain to you what the Gittins indices are. So the Gittins index of the distribution posterior P and remaining time R can be seen at the price you're willing to pay to play this arm up to an horizon F. So if you imagine a game in which you have only this arm and you can choose between paying lambda and drawing this arm, which results in a reward yt minus lambda if yt is drawn under the arm, or stopping to play and then receiving zero up to the end of the game, well, there is a critical value of lambda for which you would start by not playing. And this critical value is the Gittins index. So what we would expect for the associated index policy that we call the finite horizon Gittins algorithm is that it is also the actual optimal Bayesian strategy. But it turns out that it is not. So it was shown that the discount is really important to have the Gittins theorem. It is not, but we conjecture that it is still a good approximation of the Bayesian optimal solution. And so in simulation, I was able to compute the optimal strategy in a Bernoulli bounded problem with two arms up to horizon 70. And I was also, of course, able to compute the Gittins strategy. And you see that the base risk of these two are very close. But what is more interesting to us is that in practice, In terms of regrets, that is, if you fix the specific bandit models, Gitin's algorithm can perform also very well, as you will see on simulation later. But the thing is that the indices, even if they are easier than the optimal policy, are still hard to compute, and we could not go beyond the t equal 1000 in Bernoulli problems. So an idea to overcome this is to try to come up with approximation of the Gitin indices. And if you check the literature, you can find you can find this, for example, in the work of Murmetas and Kateakis in 2003. So they show then when the remaining time to play is large, the index policy associated to the posterior pi at is close to this. And this is very reminiscent of the KL-UCB index, except that here, in place of t, you've got a different exploration rate, where we have log of the remaining time divided by the number of draws of A so far. And actually, a different work by Lai shows that so this index policy is asymptotically, when T grows large, a good approximation of the Bayesian solution. So this shows us that, inspired by Bayesian ideas, we have here alternatives of KL-UCB algorithm using a different exploration rate. So then it remains to show that these alternative exploration rates are indeed optimal, and actually this will be a byproduct of our analysis of another Bayesian index policy, which is BYES-UCB, and that I'm going to present right now. So BYES-UCB, we proposed it with Olivier Capet and Aurélien Garriguet in 2012. So it is a simple index policy based on quantiles of posterior distribution. And the arms chosen at time t plus 1 is the arm that maximizes the quantile of order 1 minus 1 over t roughly, of the posterior of the current posterior distribution over the mean of the arm. So I will illustrate it in the Bernoulli case, again, assuming a uniform prior over the mean with this beta closed form posterior distribution. So you can picture the Bayes-UCB algorithm like this. So here I've run the algorithm for 500 time steps, and then I'm left with this posterior distribution. So beta posterior look more or less like a distorted Gaussian, except when you have drawn only zeros. And so you see that, for example, this arm has been drawn a lot, which is good, and it has a very peaky posterior, whereas some arms that have been drawn less have a quite flat posterior. And then the algorithm is looking at some quantile of the distribution and choosing the arm with the highest quantile. And by the way, if an arm is not drawn, its posterior distribution stays the same for several rounds, but the level of confidence increases, so that in the end, all the arms are going to be So here we have the behavior we expect, a massive draw of the optimal arm and a logarithmic say a draw of the other arms. So in this paper we gave an analysis of Bayes-UCB in the Bernoulli case, assuming the uniform prior, but now I'm going to present you some theoretical elements giving an analysis also for exponential families, so our setup, with quite general choices of prior distribution. So more what I show is the following. So if I fix some exponential family bandit model in which the means are in some open interval, then I can take any prior distribution that is a product distribution and for which each marginal has a density with respect to the Lebesgue measure that is strictly positive. And so if I take that, actually, in exponential family, it is easy to show that the posterior distribution at t is going to depend only on two sufficient statistics, the number of draws of the arm and the empirical mean of the rewards obtained. And what is interesting is to see that you can rewrite so this function pi a and x, which is the posterior over arm A, if one has n draws with empirical mean x, we can show that this has a density which is proportional to exponential minus n dxu, where d is the important informational function. So So this will help us derive some important posterior tail bounds that that we will need. So with this notation, the Bayes-UCB algorithm rewrites in this way. And this is a slide where I tell you the truth. I did not actually analyze the Bayes-UCB algorithm, but a slight variant of the algorithm that in particular needs to know a lower bound and an upper bound on the mean of the rewrite. So in the Bernoulli case, this means that you would need that the means are in some interval epsilon 1 minus epsilon, where epsilon can be as small as you want. And actually, the index policy for which I was able to prove the asymptotic optimality is the following. So here, compared to the original Bayes-UCB, the mean mu hat 80, so the empirical mean, is replaced by some regularized empirical mean that is constrained to lie in the interval mu 1, mu minus, mu plus. And so for this algorithm, the expected number of draws from A up to time T is actually bounded by log T divided by the right informational constant. So where does this come from? I told you, it comes from from bounds on the tail of posterior distribution that will lead to a good control of the quantiles. And so we show the following. So these are deterministic results that hold for pi a and x, so the posterior after n draws with empirical mean x. And so what we control is the probability under this distribution of some interval v mu plus. So if v is larger than our current empirical mean x, then we expect the posterior probability of this interval to be small. And actually, we show that it is of order E minus N D of XV, so what we expect, this informational complexity. And if V is smaller than X, then we expect the posterior probability of this interval to be not too small. And actually, we prove that it is larger than 1 minus 1 divided by root T approximately. So now I'm going to explain you how to use this result to do a little part of the proof. So what we have to prove for such an algorithm is to control, to show that the probability that mu 1, so the mean of the best arm, exceeds its quantile. We have to show that the probability of this event is small. And so mu 1 exceeds the quantile. This means that the posterior probability of the interval mu 1 mu plus is smaller than 1 over t log t, just by definition of the quantile. And then we consider two cases. So either mu 1 is smaller than the regularized empirical mean, in which case we can apply 2, and this leads to that inequality. And in the second case, so if mu 1 is larger than mu bar, then we apply 1. And here, actually, if t is large enough, this will lead to n1s being strictly larger than t, and this will be empty, actually, for large t. So we are left with just this quantity, which we write in the following way. So we have to control the deviation of the empirical mean to the true mean in terms of KL divergence. And this, actually, we know how to do in the analysis of KL-UCB, except that in KL-UCB, here we've got a T, and here we have an alternative exploration rate of the form of T divided by M1T. So now I'm not going to give you any more details of the proof, but so the other key ingredient was to control this probability. And what is cool is that actually it gives us for free the analysis of the two policies that I talked about and that I presented as coming from an approximation of the Gittins indices. So these two policies are KL-UCB H+, which uses an exploration rate log of the horizon divided by NIT, and also an anytime version that I call KL-UCB+, that uses as an exploration rate log t divided by nit. So these two algorithms are also asymptotically optimal, just like Bayes-UCB. And actually, KL-UCB+ known that this is a trick that works quite well in practice, but now it is also justified from a theoretical perspective. So now I'm going to illustrate the different index policies that I talked about on some simulations. So the first simulations are performed on a relatively short horizon, so that they can include the finite horizon gating algorithm that I told you was quite heavy to implement. So here we have so the regret on two-armed Bernoulli-Bandit model of so the different variants of KLUCB, BIES-UCB, Gittins algorithm, and also Thompson sampling, which is another Bayesian policy that has raised quite a lot of interest. So it is a randomized policy. I can tell you more about this offline. And what you see is that so Gittins in black perform actually quite well, and BIES-UCB in green also. And the variants of KLUCB improve a little bit on the original algorithm. And so this is confirmed on the larger horizon. Here it's 20,000, which does not allow, of course, to implement the Gittins algorithm. So here I use the 10-armed bandit problem with small rewards. And so the black curves are the expected regrets, so the expectation of the quantity I define as the regret, and these are just a confidence region, because to estimate this quantity we use a lot of facts. And you see the same thing that Richard observed this morning. What I put in blue here is a line robin lower bound, and you see that the algorithm is below the lower bound, which also illustrates the fact that this lower bound is quite asymptotic. So that's it. So I've presented to you several index policies that can be seen as inspired by the Bayesian MAB, either because they directly use the posterior distribution, or that can be seen view as some approximation of the Bayesian optimal solution. So we've seen that a few of them are optimal, so BIES-UCB and KLUCB plus and KLUCB H plus. And for small horizon, I would really encourage you to try the Gittins algorithm, since it can be quite good result. So among all these policies, the most interesting is BIES-UCB, because it answers all the question we had, because the indices are actually simpler to implement. They just require to compute the quantile of a well-known distribution, and it is also easier to generalize beyond exponential family bandit model, so to any model in which you can maintain a posterior distribution over the mean of your art. Thank you for your attention.
So we have time for one question, and maybe a few other questions during the coffee break. In 1 hour. So are there any questions? Okay, so I have a very silly question. Where does the log come from, the log to see over T in the probability you take in the quantile?
Okay, so actually, I write it here. You mean this?
Yeah.
So this is just, I mean, to be able to do the proof, you need a C equal 7, but in practice, you use C equal 0. So it's just that the probability of coverage of your confidence interval is large enough to have some series that converge. So it's really for technical reasons. But in practice, yeah, should have removed it.